In this video, we're going to talk all about the loops in the Golang. So make sure you sit back, relax. This video is going to be a little bit longer. Hey there everyone, Hitesh here, and welcome to another video of the Golang series. This video is going to be a bit fun because we are talking about the loops. Loops are like the essential superpower that everybody needs while writing any kind of code. So obviously we need some elements on which we can loop through it. And what are the different kind of loops available in Golang? And without any surprise, Go just support one kind of loop, which is just for loop. But you might be missing while loop if you're coming up from another languages. And you can actually use while loop here, but the syntax and the keywords are a little bit different. So let me walk you through with that. It's actually really, really easy. So I'm going to simply go ahead and declare my Go main package here. And we need a couple of variables to get started with that. First and foremost, I'm going to declare a simple variable, just one, nothing fancy here. I'm going to need another one here. So I'm going to simply say, I want to have things. And this is just things. And we are going to have an array of few things. So we're going to have the string. What I would like to insert here is few things, but not in English, but in Spanish, so that I can teach you a bit Spanish as well. So we're going to go for maleta, which means a suitcase. We're going to go for bolso, means a purse. And we're going to go for boleto, which means a ticket. And we're going to go for vaso, which means a vase, a flower pot, something like that. And what else? We are going to go for casa. Pretty easy to remember. That means a home. There we go. Enough of the Spanish classes. Now we're going to go back. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and first and foremost, I'm going to simply print out these things so that it doesn't give me error that, hey, you have declared it but haven't used it. Moving further, now I would like to introduce you with the loops. Now, loop is pretty easy in the Golang. They follow the exact same structure that you might have studied in the for loop in the C language. So for, we declare a word, simply I, for just like iteration. And we're going to give this initial value of 0. Then separated by colon, we do a comparison that what is going to be trigger or the conditional check for this loop. So let's just say if I is less than 10, then we simply go ahead and just use that. And we also need an incrementer, so we're going to go for i++. So as you can see, this is exactly like the C style structure, but the only thing that's missing is parentheses, which is not present in the Golang. And then you can simply go ahead and say, I want to print whatever the value of I is, but I want to add a start value to it so that we don't see the zeroth value. We are going to see the first value as 1. So let's just save that and run that. So we're going to go ahead and run that. Without any doubt, we get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So no big deal, no big deal there. Now, let's go ahead and try to loop through over these stuff because that's what you'll be doing majority of time, looping through an array or something like that. So there are a couple of ways how you can loop through with these arrays. The most common one is going to be, again, the C style. Most importantly, when you declare any variable in the loop, the scope of that variable is just right here. That means inside the for loop only. After that, it's no longer valid. And the automatic garbage collection of Golang handles that. So I don't need to worry about that. Okay, moving further, we're going to declare again a variable starting with the 0. But since I want to loop over the things this time, I'm going to use an inbuilt stuff here. So I'm going to simply compare my variable. Keep running this loop till I is less than the length of this things. There we go. Nice and easy. And of course, we need an incrementer. We're going to go inside that. We're going to print. And I want to print individual and each value out of these things. So I'm going to simply say, hey, I want to use things. And I am going to just provide you an index of I there. Nice and easy. No big deal. All super simple. We run that and we see all the values, maleta, bolso, boleto, basso, and casa. There we go. Nice and easy. But what you're going to notice that this is all the working fine and nice. But in the recent, like in the modern world, we need another loop which can easily loop through with the arrays in the shorter syntax called as a range-based loop as well that are also being supported. Pretty easy to use as well. You can go ahead and simply say, I want to loop through. I'm going to use a variable I, which is going to go ahead and run for the range of this things. So that's the syntax of having it. And rest of the things remains exactly same. You use the things and you go for I. Now comparing it with the above loop that we have used, This one definitely is a lot shorter. We use a new keyword here, which is range, which automatically goes through with this an array and keeps on incrementing the value of I automatically. We don't use the keyword of length. We don't need to increment that. It does happen automatically inside that. We can save that and run that again. We're gonna see the two lists this time. One is here, Maleta and stuff, and one is going up here as well, the last one. There we go, pretty easy, no big deal. Everything is super easy and fine. Okay, moving forward, what you're gonna notice in this is that there is no while loop actually in the Golang. But it's not like it's the while loop is totally absent. You can use actually for loop in kind of syntax of this while loop. Let me show you what does that mean. So we're going to print up the values from 0 to 100, let's just say. I can simply go ahead and say, hey, I have a variable start, and till it is less than 100, just keep on printing the stuff. And inside that, we're going to simply say start is going to be plus equal start. There we go, nice and easy. And then I can simply go ahead and say I want to print out the value of start. So I'm going to say start is now, and I'm going to add up start. So there we go. Now this doesn't really look like we are not using the keyword while, of course, but this almost looks like a while loop. So we have a for keyword, then we have got a conditional true and false being evaluated, and there we go. So there are a couple of styles in the for loop that you can use. I can run that again, and we see that start is now 2. 1 was the initial value, so it got updated up here. 1 plus equals 1, that gets 2, then 2 plus equals 2, so we are getting a 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, and 128, of course. So this is a bit a structure about how this goes on. And of course, as I said, this is all about loops. I would also like to introduce you with the three basic keywords that you might have studied in other languages as well. Break, continue, and go to is also supported in the Golang. I was a bit surprised with that when I was reading the docs. So how we can actually do that? I'm going to come up here and I would like to add a conditional. So this is my conditional. What is your condition? So we can see that our start is actually going to 2, 4, 8, 16. I would like to go for 32, I guess. So when the start is actually exactly equals to 32, I'm going to go ahead and say just break. And I'm pretty sure some of you knows how the break word works. Break, whenever we hit the key point of break, that means go outside of this for loop and stop the execution of that particular block, whether that's for. In this case, it's just for, so let's just talk about it. So we simply hit the break, so we definitely get out of this for block and we reach at exact this moment at line number 32. Go ahead, run that again, and there we go. We can see that start 2, 4, 8, 16. This is how it's going on. Pretty easy, pretty fun. Let's just say instead of the break, we use the keyword continue. Then things are a bit different. Continue means just skip this one part. Like whenever we hit this point, the continue, it's gonna say, hey, just go up here and start looping again. Just skip this one particular routine that you are doing, whatever you are doing. I run this again and we can see that now we didn't got the 32 this time. Rest of the stuff is working fine. So that's the key difference between the break and continue. Break simply just breaks out of the loop or whatever you are doing. Continue means just whenever you meet me, just keep on continue doing it, but just skip this one point. Okay. Now, one of the most a bit awkward syntax, not just awkward, but it's a strange for the modern language that it supports a go-to syntax. And I actually love that syntax. It sometimes gets really, really handy. So what we can do is we can define any label here. Feel free to name it anything, even Superman, that's fine. Just put a colon after that. That actually defines that, yes, this is a label. And then you define your entire block of code, that what you really want to do. In this case, I just want to print out simply learn code online.in, which is my website name. And what I can do after that is whenever I hit this 32, I can mention the keyword go to. And whenever I say go to, I have to mention the label where I want to go. And there can be multiple labels in your particular code statement. In this case, I have got this one label only. And that's where we want to go after 32. And once you go to this label, you are not going to be coming back once you're gone, it's just you are gone out of this loop. So let me save that and show it to you. When I run this one again, we can see after 16, 32, whenever this condition meets at 32, this line is not gonna execute. It directly goes to this line number 33 where my label resides. And I can simply just execute whatever the code or bunch of code that I have. It can be multi-line of code, of course, whoever is gonna write just one line of code, but that's what we have got. So there we go, quite a lengthy discussion about learning a bit of Spanish as well as a bit of syntax about for loop and stuff. And of course, this label part is actually one of my favorite one. It's long that I have seen that. So there we go, that's all about the for loop in this one. I'll catch you up in the next video.